All right, I think it's time for me to announce the next speaker. His name is Michel. He's gonna connect his laptop while I'm introducing him. His name is Michel, and he is our very own Dutch open source framework boss man as a creator of MobX, hailing from Rotterdam, lead developer at Mendix. And he also was one of the smash hit speakers at React Amsterdam last year. It was my personal introduction to MobX last year. And Michel will take you, will take us on a tour through reactive programming land and why that is such a great idea. Please give a warm applause for Michel Westrate.
Good afternoon, all. I do realize it's 5 p.m. on Friday, so you're now all working overtime. So I figured I should start with some cheesy history story. So does anybody have a clue what this map pictures? These are the, wow, somebody knows, really cool. These are the conquests by Julius Caesar 40 years before Christ. And he conquered all that land by defeating all the enemy's armies. All of them, well, except for a small village. But that's a different story. Does anybody have any idea what this map depicts? This is the French Empire in the 19th century under Napoleon. And he also was able to conquer all this land by just defeating enemies. And now you might be wondering, how was he able to do that? Did he have larger armies than the enemy? Well, the answer is no. What these two people had in common was that they followed the same tactic. And the tactic was divide et impera, divide and rule, or as you know it, divide and conquer. What they did was that they always, under any circumstance, tried to avoid a confrontation with the whole of the enemy's army and only tried to attack a small part of it. So they tried all different kind of tactics to achieve that. Either they attacked early, or they attacked at an unexpected place, or they even faked a retreat so that they would be chased and they could attack only a small portion of the enemy, and then they defeated them and they went on to the next part. Now, why is that relevant today? I can imagine that most of you have all a long time ago already given up the dream to become a warlord or a famous general. All of you? Well, not all of you. Some people are still playing with crossbows and those kind of things. I mean, look at the smile on that face. He's really enjoying it. Way to go, Ken. Go on. But this is the point I want to make. I think everybody can agree with this point. Small, isolated problems are much easier to deal with than big, intertwined problems. Right? And one of the ways in which we can deal this, which we can apply this, is by using reactive programming. Now, I'm aware that reactive programming is still a quite scary concept for a lot of people. It sounds very complicated. So I tried to find the least scary definition of reactive programming. And that's by Heinrich Abtemus, an author of a Haskell RFP library. And it says, the essence of functional reactive programming is to specify the dynamic behavior of a value completely at the time of declaration. In other words, it separates the question of how a value should behave from the question when that behavior should be applied. You define the behavior of a value, and then whatever reactive library you're using will make sure that that behavior is consistent in any time in the future. You don't have to deal with the when anymore. Now let's apply that to React, a reactive view library. So this is the example from the front page. It's a simple timer component. And what we see is that it defines the rendering in terms of the state. So it's just a function that transforms the state into a view. And then in the future, we start changing the state, but we don't worry about how these changes are applied back to the UI. That's what React does for us. So basically, this is often thought to be the philosophy behind React, that the view is just a function of your state. And the important thing to realize is that that is not just a one-time application of that function. Now, it's a continuous one. For any future new state, there will be a future new view. Now, that's pretty cool, but there are some downsides to this model. And that is that React only is reactive when we talk about the state and the props of a component, but it doesn't react to any state that lives outside of components. So although it allows us to separate the how from the when, it doesn't allow us to separate state from our views. So we get strong coupling just in a different place. And there are a few downsides to that. One of them, it's kind of hard to share state between components, because if you want to do that, then state tends to bubble up in your tree, and then you get those top-heavy components. For the same reason, it's also hard to move components around if, like the design guys, come with a completely different layout of whatever you're building, and then that will probably also affect how your state is shaped. And that in turn makes it also hard to optimize, and it makes it hard to test just the state and logic in isolation, because you also need the components to be there, because they contain the state, and the other way around, it makes it hard to test the components in isolation, because they make lots of assumptions on the state they get passed in from their parents. So, I think we need some more divide and conquer. And one solution, obviously, is MobX. But fear not, Redux does the same. But I will be talking about MobX more, because somehow I'm more familiar with it. And the conceptual model behind it is that basically, in an application, you have input, the application is in a certain state, and you have output. And the state is basically kept in observables. And there are actions, there are inputs that are starting to modify the state. And these can be either user events or incoming WebSocket messages or whatever. And separately from that, our application state can be transformed into new values, and values that can be expressed in terms of what's in our state. So like the amount of unfinished to-do items or something like that. And that's a bit sadly, in the end, we also need always, in any application, side effects. Because without side effects, we cannot produce output. We cannot send something to the screen without the side effect. So that's the basic model, the reactive model behind MobX. And the job of MobX is that when you're in the orange box changing something, you don't worry about the green and red boxes reacting to that. So that's the job that MobX does for you, or what any other reactive library does for you. So make sure that your data changes are consistently processed. And why do we do that? And that's basically inspired on the whole concept of spreadsheets, which are quite a natural way of thinking, which is proven by the simple fact that Ant is the most successful software product in the world, and the fact that you don't have to be a software engineer to use it. While it's still kind of programming. So it makes it all more declarative and helps you to find a minimal state. So if you apply the same model to a spreadsheet, then your state are the contents of your data cells. Your actions are the fact that user starts updating those data cells. And then the values that are derived are your formulas, your graphs. And in the end, there is probably some C code or something that draws all that stuff on the screen whenever it changes. And as I said, same applies to React. You have your components, state, and props. Set state, update your state. And from that, your render function produces a render tree, and that's a value, but a value you use nowhere as a programmer. Now, instead, that value is sent to the virtual DOM algorithm, and it uses that value to update your DOM as a side effect as efficiently as possible. So what MobX in combination with React allows you to do is to have state outside of your component and still be subscribing to it. So here we have the same example, but just the state now lives outside of the component. But nonetheless, the component will still reactively react to that state. So as a short recap, React programming separates the how from the when, and MobX helps you to separate the state from the view. Now that brings us to an interesting question, and that's actually what I want to talk about. So if your view is just a pure function of your state, then what happens if you throw away your view? That shouldn't affect your application in any kind, right? Because it's just a pure function, so you can do without it, and you still have your state, and you still have a working application, you just can't see anything. So that's in an ideal world, but in practice, it's harder. Because is the app still usable, at least from a command line or testing perspective? Well, it's kind of tricky to navigate around if there are no anchors anymore. And also, the question arises, who's going to fetch my data from the server if there are no smart components around anymore that will fetch my data when I'm walking through my application? Actually, the question I want to pose is, can we make our UI dumb enough to make our app usable without an UI? And here's a short demo. So this is a simple bookshop, and you can navigate around, and you go to a book, and you can add it to your cart, and then check out the cart, and then books are removed from the store. Now, the interesting thing is that I can do the same from the command line. So I'm now navigating through the application, and you see the address bar, if that's visible. You see it updating, and we go to another page, and we can even go then to our cart and check out our cart. And see it all happening, but we just do it programmatically. We don't click anywhere. And even more funny, now we can throw away our entire rendering. What we see, well, is nothing, of course, because nothing gets rendered. But still, this application works the same. I can still navigate to a specific book. You can't really see that, except in the URL, which is now correct. And I can add that book still to my cart, and the data is still fetched from the server. And I can still check that book out. So I have a working application, even though there's no UI. So my view function is really pure, because nothing changed in its behavior. So that proves that we can divide state and view entirely. And that means that we can now solve those problems one by one at a time. Now, how was this done? Why is this application working? Well, first of all, the most hard and most important thing is that you cannot depend on component hooks anymore to do your data fetching. Because if there's no component, then there's obviously no data fetching. And also, you can't rely on clicking links or something to navigate around to put your application in a new state. But we can leverage the four reactive boxes, and that's why I'm going to demonstrate. So first of all, how can we eliminate those components that mount hooks? And this is like a mental exercise. So first question, why do we want to fetch the data? Well, obviously, because our component needs this. Kind of stupid question. Next question, why is the component there? And now we're getting a bit philosophical. So the first answer is, of course, 42. But beyond that, there are several reasons why a component exists. First of all, simplest case, it's just always there. It's just part of the tree of the application, which is always rendered, like your top-level components. Otherwise, it's probably because your parent is in a certain state. either there are to-dos, and for that reason, some to-do views get rendered. Or the router mounted it. You navigated to a certain URL, and then the router injected this component to the tree. Now, to be able to lift this data fetching out of the component, we have to make the one who causes the component to exist to take the responsibility of the fetching. So can we make component caller responsible? And the simplest case in which we can solve that is the case where the component does always exist. So if my booklist component fetches the data during or after mounting, then instead I can just fetch the data whenever the application is created, completely outside the component. And remember, the reason that we can do that is because components can, with MobX, reactively react to state that lives outside a component. So we can just pull it out, and our component that was first a complex component fetching data is now just a simple function component. And if the parent causes the existence of a component, then there is somewhere a state transition that causes my book list to exist. For example, in this artificial example, if I click the show books. So in that case, I can lift that responsibility up to this state transition. And actually, people with some more experience using MobX often also model that as a reactive side effect. So if my state changes in a certain way, then certain components are rendered, which is a reactive happening. But also, for the same state chains, I can start fetching data. And if the router mounts my component, then I'm kind of in trouble, because there's no action outside this book list component where I can easily transfer this responsibility to. So actually, where we have first this clean reactive model, where actions change state, state update views, and views lead to side effects, to reactions, we now suddenly have a URL change, and then the router might start changing our view. And then in turn, even the hooks of that view might start messing with our state. So actually, we have some conceptual mismatch here, which makes it hard to separate completely our view from our state. So it's kind of if you are sending some document to the printer, and then you expect whatever is printed to be a pure transformation of whatever was in your document, but then somebody takes a scissor and starts changing letters all over the place, and you suddenly get a different letter. That's what happens if you mess with output which is derived. So I'm going to show you later how to solve that. But first, a bit more about this bookshop architecture. And this is, by the way, if you have visited our booth in the main hall, also the architecture which is behind the Mendix web modeler. Just a lot more simplified. So what we started with is one store which captures the entire logic and state of our application. And it's called just a shop store. And it has, in turn, two smaller stores, one containing the books and one containing the cart entries. And they're not really exciting. So beyond that, they're not very interesting. But the interesting thing is that we can now, because the data fetching happens in our stores instead of in our components, we can just write unit tests against the store to verify that data fetching is happening without having an UI. So when the shop is done loading, we expect there is the correct amount of books. Now, remember this problem I just talked about. So what really is happening here is that if the view is to be purely derived from just the state, then routing should affect our state and not our output, the view. So instead, we want to go to a different model where URL is just like an action, just like any user that clicks a button or pops an URL is the same, it's an action, which is about to change the state, and that will lead to an updated view, instead of messing with our view directly. So conceptually, instead of mounting a component, we just call some store method to transition our application to the correct page, to the correct state. Now, for that, you need to capture your navigation state. So you need to store in your state what view is the user currently on. But that is pretty straightforward in general. I mean, the simple solution to that is having a simple enumeration expressing on which page the user currently is, and also storing the parameters of that view. So, and then we can just introduce functions that transitions the state from one page to another. And you see here, we can also start fetching the data. So now the state transition from one page to another is entirely out of our view, but in our stores and logic. So at this point, which is very interesting, we can start using user flows. So we can take a user use case, user scenario, and start testing it through. Even though we still don't have any UI, we can still say, when the person opens the book, then I expect the books to be loaded, then he can navigate to a specific book, add it to his cart, and check it out. And we transition to all the application completely without UI. So that makes sure that we can conquer or defeat the first army, and that is testing our logic. So when we've done that, then we can focus on the second part, the second enemy, and that is doing the actual rendering of this application, because we still have nothing on screen. So, and how we usually do that is that when the application fires up, we instantiate that store, and we provide it to the component tree, and then we just mount our root component. And our root component can then be a simple function component that takes that job, and based on the view state of that job, renders the correct subcomponent representing the correct page. So these now become all really dumb components, because they're just all transforming state into a view and nothing else. And same if you have like book details and somebody clicks the button, then we can just invoke the appropriate action in our stores. And it all becomes a really thin layer now. And interesting enough, also for links, instead of now depending on URLs being pushed and popped, we can immediately programmatically change to the new state, because we have these state functions in the store anyway. So we can make the state transition immediately, and we get all the nice ID assistance about that open book page function exists, etc. So it's much stronger typed. So then we have our view, but we don't have any real routing yet. We don't have integration with the browser history API. But that's a problem that can now be simply solved as well. So we can now just take any router library, any generic one. We don't need anything specific for React anymore. And we just start listening for URL changes. And whenever a certain URL is matched, we can transition the store to that new page. And we know that our view will just reactively react to that. So that makes it pretty straightforward and completely at the edge of our application. There's another problem you have to solve when doing the routing. Because we can now programmatically transition from one state to another state, we have to, at certain points, or want to, update the URL bar. So if you go programmatically to a new state, you want to make still sure that that URL is matching your new page. But the URL, we can simply derive back from whatever state is in our view store. So for the book URL, we just take book URL and construct that URL again. So this is just a derived value. And if we start listening reactively to this derived value, we can just, whenever that URL changes, push it into the history API, and our URL gets updated. So this is on the output part. So now we have routing also captured in our nice reactive model, where a route change is just an action starting to modify chains, and in the out, and we produce two different outputs. One is an updated DOM, and the other one is an updated address bar location. So basically, separating state and view enables you to conquer different enemies at different times. You can do it in different teams. At Mendix, we have our state even in a different packets distributed separately from our actual UI. And it makes it much cheaper to do UI testing because you can postpone all the browser nastiness, all the Selenium stuff, or whatever ugliness you're using to a later point, which personally I like. So that usually makes me feel like Napoleon conquering half of Europe. So that's basically what I wanted to share with you. I will push the demo repository soon and this presentation. There will be a workshop in much more detail about this and other complex architectural things at the Exhibia. Of course, we're hiring, so visit our booth if you didn't do yet. And finally, for the people who did do that, there was a lottery involving Code Motion tickets, and there are 4 people who won them. So I'm gonna read them out quickly and probably wrongly. So make sure to visit our booth if you think I mentioned your name. And the first one to win such a ticket is Rajasthan Kashmir Sak. So congrats. Michael Turner. Christoph Fudali. And Tim Koopman. That one I could manage. So, thanks a lot.